I remember to this day, probably one of the single greatest moments I've had at Netpicks, where we were about to start the teleseminar, and you had a button where you can turn it on. Everybody can say hello. And I remember turning this thing on, and it was like an unbelievable sound of like over 1,000 people all saying hello at once. You couldn't understand anybody, but you're like, holy crap. When I hit mute, I was like, this is gonna work.
You're listening to Deal Closers, brought to you by WebsiteClosers.com, a show about how to build your e-commerce business to be profitable, scalable, and one day, even sellable. I'm Jason Gillikin, and on the show today, Website Closers Isaac Porter and Brent Fisher chat with two serial entrepreneurs, Mark Soberman and Brian Short, who just sold a company that launched all the way back in 1996. Let's think about 1996 for a moment. Google didn't exist yet. Netscape was the number one browser, and Microsoft's Internet Explorer was a distant second. Internet connections were dial-up and had a max speed of about 30 kilobits per second. Most internet speeds are about 500 times faster now. I remember back in 1996 begging my parents to let me get a Hotmail email account and them saying no, because no one gives away anything for free. It was a different world, and yet that's where Mark Soberman decided to try something by building Netpicks, which provides training tips and courses on how to make money in the market. Growing up, Mark was an entrepreneur from go.
Having a business was just kind of like second nature. When I was in high school, I was reselling computer products, printers, computers, etc. I was hooking up with computer distributors back then, and was probably one of the early mail order people down in San Diego. So it was just always something that I gravitated towards. I was kind of on one track, telling my parents that I wanted to be a doctor to make them happy, and the other track knowing that was never going to be reality, and business is kind of what spoke to me.
Mark did have some quote-unquote real jobs after the travel agency. He worked at two tech startups, but he quickly figured out that wasn't his path either.
But along the way, I kind of just realized that it probably wasn't for me. I wasn't the best person at reporting to somebody. Wasn't the best person that kind of, you know, listened to what I thought were sometimes dumb ideas. So I kind of knew that ultimately, more than likely, I was going to have to do my own thing. So in like 1995 or so, I was at a technology company that had just, you know, gone public a few months before, was running their marketing department, and started this business called Netpicks. However, Netpicks didn't originally start in the same niche that it's in now. I had a great interest in sports picking, sports gambling, which has become a huge industry now. I was always very early, unfortunately, on some things. But Netpicks was originally a sports picking, sports handicap website.
No kidding.
Yeah, that's kind of how it started. In fact, I think years ago when we had a company conference, we got everybody together, we were able to find on the internet some of the early gyrations of the website, which is always kind of entertaining to see what it used to look like. But it kind of had the sports picking bent. That didn't last all that long. I got out of that. You know, the bookie business is not really one for the duration. Let's just put it that way. So I love the name, though. But I also had an interest in investing. Thought, Netpicks, kind of a good name for something if I was going to get into this investing business. And at the time, there was just, I think it was one other company out there online that was offering any kind of analysis, any kind of picks. And I knew for me, I had spent about 10 years, 12 years trying to become a better investor. I had my first investments like in the mid 80s. I got super lucky on a couple options trades. And then I probably had like a 10-year struggle after that. The worst thing was I had success early, didn't know what I was doing, thought that I did. And then I spent, you know, 10 years trying to figure it out. And I got to a point where I was getting relatively decent. I was like, maybe there's an audience for this. And again, this was back in the mid 90s. I mean, people were just starting to get online. Everybody had an AOL address if they were online. And a lot of our first customers, we delivered the picks via fax machines. So that's definitely to this day something that I do remember. So that's some of the early.
That's awesome. So you're delivering these via fax. Like, how are people finding you then? Like, are they finding you online, or are you marketing them some other way?
Yeah, it was online. The business was an online business from the start. So I literally created this website with some template-based system out there. I can't exactly remember the name of it. I think it was published by a company, Sierra Online. I forget the exact publishing package that they put out. They were the video game company, but they got into, website development at the time. So nothing like we have today. I put it online. And the nice thing was there was not a lot of competition. So back then, even though the audience was much smaller, You didn't have competition. We weren't doing paid advertising. Everything was discovered via organic initially. So to be perfectly honest, the business then was easy because it was quite easy to get customers. You didn't have to be sophisticated. There was just no such thing as worrying about lead generation and grabbing an email and developing a relationship. You didn't have to do any of that. Basically, all you did was you offered a trial. Somebody took a trial. You set up your billing, basically your recurring billing. And by the way, that was quite difficult back then. Again, there wasn't like all the systems there are now. Brian, you may or may not remember this, but originally the only people doing recurring billing was the porn industry at the time. So we set up with Net Billing, which was the company that was doing all of the porn billing. And that was the industry that really kind of set the pace for online. It really was the groundbreaker at the time.
So many great innovations come out of porn. You know?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, especially then. I mean, they really were first to everything. Right. And it was a great system. So that's how we were able to set up, you know, the subscriptions. And that was kind of version one of Netpicks. Three times a week, analysis, picks, done by me. It was a solo business at the time. I remember getting married and going on my honeymoon, and I would do three updates a day. We were in Hawaii, so I'd wake up at 2 in the morning, 6 in the morning, and then at 10 in the morning. That was kind of what you did in order to get these picks out for everybody. So, but always online, and that was the way that it was done initially.
And then you sent the picks via fax to the people that want them via fax.
I'd say about 2/3 of the people initially were fax, and the other third, I was teaching them how to use the internet. So that was kind of how it started.
So how did you establish credibility? How did you get to the point where you're like, you know, I've got some juice here. Like people are following along and I'm giving them value.
Yeah, it's a good question. The good part and the bad part about the business that we're in, you know, investment training, investment advice, is we're either going to be right or we're going to be wrong. There's really no in between. So everybody measures us on the latest picks, the latest analysis, the latest thing, the latest system that we put out. And you are wrong a lot. No matter how good we are in this business, no matter how good we've gotten over the years, we're still wrong and have been wrong quite often. And that is the reality. And any investor who says that they're not, or they rarely have a loss, it's a lie, or they're doing something, you know, that's, you know, just uncapped risk type of thing. So by giving somebody a trial, they would have like a 2-week trial initially. They could see probably over time, like 4, 5, 6 picks and judge for themselves. If it was working or they saw potential, obviously they would continue. They'd pay the monthly fee. If it was not, cancellation on the trial and off they went. Back then at the time, you know, the renewal rate was pretty good. I mean, it was probably like 40 to 50%, probably 50% of the time would renew and go on and take, you know, monthly subscription. Doesn't mean they would stay forever. But they would, you know, typically stay on average about 6 months back, 6 to 8 months back at that time.
So as a serial entrepreneur, you know, some of your businesses worked out okay. Some didn't really worked out. I imagine none of them had the success that Netpicks ended up having. What point were you like, oh shit, this is, I've got something here. This is something that I can actually grow.
Yeah, it was probably 97. And I was still working for the company that I mentioned. They had expanded super fast. We had, you know, a couple thousand employees. I could already tell that the expansion was going way too quick, that they were starting to have, you know, kind of the typical things you start to see when you get too big for the revenue. And I know Brian's gone through this on his own. So I sort of saw the writing on the wall, and they were trying to downsize a little bit, and they offered some buyouts. And I think they offered like a 6 or 8 month buyout. And at the time, I was being paid quite well to work there. I was working the Netpicks business, you know, with my computer faced away from what anybody could see. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to roll the dice. I won't have to use my boss key anymore, and I'll take the buyout. And if it works and I can sustain it, then I'll stay. If not, I'll go back into, you know, corporate world and in technology, which was perfectly fine at that time for me. But at that point, I already had enough customers. I felt that it could sustain full time. So I took the leap basically and went full time. And at that point is when I started to learn more about, you know, this early business called, you know, internet marketing, which was just at that point was not really a thing. There was not a lot of experts or gurus. There was no YouTube channels. There weren't a lot of places you can learn this. But I found a few people, you know, along the way. You know, years ago, a guy named Corey Rudel, who passed away many years ago, he was kind of my first like mentor. I mean, I still have the two notebooks that, you know, I got from him. And that sort of started the process of how do you market? How do you find more business? You know, how do you do the early days of pay-per-click, you know, at the time, way before Google AdWords came out. So it was kind of that process. So yeah, Overture, GoTo.com. Yep, exactly.
Yeah. And so did you start to see some traction on, you know, the advertising on Yahoo and any SEO success? And that's how you started marketing your business?
Yeah, SEO was good. And not because I was doing what you do now, which is developing a lot of content. Again, there just wasn't the level of competition. And Google was not sophisticated. So at that point, it's very easy to trick, right, the search engines. You know, pretty easy. You just did all the tactics and tricks. You didn't really try to build anything sustainable, to where that actually came back to kind of bite us years later, because the original version of the site had a lot of tricks. Well, Google got obviously very smart, and so like we had to do
a lot of meta tag links, or what were some of those
really serious. Everything you just said, it was all that, and that's what you were supposed to do. That's the game you played, and that's how it worked. At the point, it wasn't considered black hat. It was how you did SEO. You know, nobody had this thought of let's write really good long form content. And, you know, you started to do a little keyword research. You did that type of thing. But then all you did was stuff those keywords, right? It wasn't good content. It was just, again, to try to get that search volume on Yahoo, especially at the time. And then, of course, Google started to, you know, up and coming. So I wanted to start to control things a little bit. And that's kind of where paid advertising, that started. You know, I started to realize, you know, how do you control your own destiny if you rely on Google or Yahoo, even to this day? You know, you're basically, that's a recipe for disaster, I think. It can be one part of your channel, one part of your lead gen, but if it's all you rely on, eventually it's you're going to be gone. So I kind of realized we had to start doing, and when I say we, I mean me and my toothbrush, pretty much. That was the, you know, the entire team. So I had to do some PPC, and that's kind of what I started doing back then. And I was doing PPC for a lot of affiliate stuff. I was kind of honing my skills, you know, doing PPCs for stuff on ClickBank. You can make a lot of money back then doing it. So it wasn't just Netpicks. Again, it was just finding opportunities. But I think learning how to write and learning how to market and learning how to, you know, appeal to people, you know, some of their needs. Those are all the skills that I kind of picked up over those first few years.
Yeah.
So what year was it when you started doing PPC?
I think it was probably, I'm going to say 97, 98. It was early. Yeah, it was definitely in the first year of doing business. So full time was really, it started in 96, full time was 97. So it happened in, you know, that year.
Cool.
And so when did you expand beyond you and your toothbrush?
That's a good question. That was hard for me because, again, I saw the company that I left basically implode. So to see a company that was the most successful in its industry, that grew super fast, that, you know, had locations all over, big warehouses, and then all the people that I had hired eventually, you know, went on to work at, you know, all kinds of different places in technology, which was fun to watch even to this day. But to see that implode, I was really hesitant to bring anybody on to get any help. The most help that I would typically get at that point was an admin person, you know, somebody to help with the bookkeeping, somebody to help with, you know, cancellations or a little bit of customer service or that type of thing. I think really where it started, and Brian, correct me if I'm wrong, I think, were you like number two? Or am I forgetting somebody?
I think I was number two, yes. And then Anthony came along.
Yeah. So I think that's kind of what happened. I started to develop some relationships and friendships with customers, with clients. You know, there were certain clients that I had that were just great people. I actually really look forward to talking to them. When you're doing this on an isolated island, it's kind of a lonely business, and investing's tough because, like I mentioned, you're wrong all the time and your customers are on you about it. So it's a lot of pressure in this business. So we started to have some clients that, you know, really good to talk to, bounce ideas off of, and that sort of thing. Of course, there's always other clients that are the exact opposite of that. Thankfully, Brian was not that. And I think Brian approached me with, he had some ideas about some programming. He's a technical guy, and he had some ideas about how we could, or how I could possibly automate things a little bit more than I was doing in our conversations. And it sounded interesting. I was like, you know what, I'm going to go ahead and contract with Brian. So that was kind of the first time of trying that, bringing somebody else in. And it was a client. And that ended up being really our recipe, I think, for success all these years. Because I would say 99% of the people that worked for Netpicks that still work for Netpicks were customers first. There's really one exception, and that was somebody that worked for Brian, who's still with us. But everybody else was somebody who traded, somebody who was a customer, somebody who became passionate about our business. And the good news was trading is kind of, again, lonely, can be boring 90% of the day. A lot of these people want something else to do. We develop a relationship, and that's every single person that I hired thereafter was a client. And I think it spoke to the customers that we were talking to in subsequent years when they knew that the people pitching and the people backing up the products were basically them just a few years later.
What a
after having some success.
Yeah. So, what a great testament to the effectiveness of the platform, right? When you've got
customers. It was astonishing. It even helped during the process because potential buyers thought that was so amazing that you guys had really developed something special. And I don't know whether it was by design or just organically happened, but that's a pretty awesome way to hire people.
It made a huge difference. I mean, because most of our people to this day, you know, have been here 10, 15 years. It's rare that we've ever lost anybody other than maybe by our choice. So we've had tremendous loyalty that way, which has been great. We were doing remote work before it was cool, you know, before COVID, we were doing all this. So we kind of built the business that way, gave our people nice flexibility. But at the same time, they got to be part of something a little bit bigger and they got to, you know, give back more, you know, with their skill set and then really monetize, you know, their experience. So I think it's kind of the perfect combination. And anytime we needed to hire, in fact, we, you know, hired somebody somewhat recently, we would just send out an email and we would always get 50 to 100 people to apply. And I'm talking good people. I mean, it was hard always to pick the person because there was like 5 or 10 people I would be happy with. So we've always had that kind of, I guess, luck that way.
Yeah. Brian, let's go to you. I believe from your bio, you're a serial entrepreneur as well.
Yes, very similar story to Mark. I started in corporate for 3 years. At the end of that 3 years, I knew I didn't want to do that ever again. So there was a family business in my past also. We owned a propane company. I'm a programmer by trade during those years. I started a computer consulting company that I ran for 20 years. And in 2004, I sold that company. And so at that point, I was looking for something else to do. I didn't know what that next thing was. And I had subscribed to Netpicks, the service at that point, and really liked what was going on there and the picks and just that process. And as Mark alluded to, I approached him and I said, hey, this was on a Forex signal service that he had at the time. It was issuing signals on the different currency pairs. I said, I can automate that and trade it automatically for customers. And we can sell that as a combination package. And he liked that idea. And that was really our first project together, as he mentioned. And then from there, we just formed a really good relationship business-wise. And he and I think a lot alike. And I think that helps the process. And yeah, it's just been a fun journey over these last few years in that regard.
How did you get into online trading even before joining up with Netpicks?
Yeah, that's a great story too. So this goes back to the 90s. I've been a trader for as long as my working career. So this goes back to the days when your broker would call you up and give you the hot tip of the day. And in the 90s, we did my business partner then, we did great. We were making 6 figures, 7 figures in some years with that approach. And there was a 18-month period at the end of the 90s where we basically lost it all. I mean, they just drove us into the ground. And it was after that point, I was like, you know what? I'm tired of relying on somebody else. I want to rely on something that I can have control over and something that gives me the edge in the market. And that's really how I got interested in trading. And more specifically, we're active day traders and actually long-term traders too, a little bit of that. But so yeah, that's my trading past. And now going forward, as a you know, actively involved in Netpicks, I call a live room every day. I have members come in and we look at the markets, we apply a strategy, and we navigate our way through the price action, good or bad, every day. Like Mark said, some days don't work so well. In fact, today was one of those days. Mm-hmm. And I had to kind of play the psychological coach, say, you know what, you're going to have these days, but the 2 days prior were awesome. So anyways, that's the process and how I got interested in trading. And it's just been a fun journey inside of Netpicks, taking that skill set and giving back to people. And so, yeah.
So what does the model look like now? I mean, it's 26 years since the company started, and you know, you were giving tips back then and sending the faxes. But now it's so much more than just tips. From what I understand, there's courses, right? And like there's other things that are available. So what's the model for Netpicks now?
Yeah, I mean, one of the reasons I think we've stayed relevant this long, because when you do something like this for this many years, I've seen a lot of my competitors come and go. So it's been a cycle of people that burst onto the scene, probably get quite a bit larger than us, and then they're gone. And there's like these 5 to 7 year sort of cycles that we've had. So I feel like I've been through about 6 of these, you know, so far. But that's meant that we've had to sort of reinvent ourselves multiple times. You know, like you mentioned in the beginning, doing picks 3 times a week, that was kind of how we started. Along the way, we did get into courses, and that was probably one of the big transformations in the business. And that actually came from that idea at the time, because it was still kind of new. It's not new anymore. Now it seems like it's every day. You know, courseware is very common. But I had purchased a consulting program with Perry Marshall. You know, he's kind of one of the old guys out there that has been promoting, you know, PPC and courses and things forever. And I remember it was like $12,000. It was a lot. And it was like myself and I think somebody else that I had in my team at the time. And we would just do these, you know, these calls, these weekly calls. And I honestly thought it was a total waste of time. I felt I had spent $12,000. It was a complete waste because we covered a lot of different things. None of it I really thought applied. But the one idea that he gave us was you need to release a course. And we're like, okay, seems like a decent idea. We'll give it a shot. So that's kind of when we started to transform. I don't really remember the exact year this was, but we developed our first course. And Brian, you may remember, it was Ultimate Trading Machine. This was course number one. Mm-hmm. And it was $997. And we followed everything Perry Marshall taught. And again, I was still thinking, I think the guy ripped me off. But we did everything. You know, we followed everything. We invited people to not a webinar, because back then there weren't really webinars. We did a teleseminar. And so I remember to this day, probably one of the single greatest moments I've had at Netpicks, where we were about to start the teleseminar and you had a button where you can turn it on and we could, you know, everybody could say hello. And I remember turning this thing on and it was like an unbelievable sound of like over 1,000 people. I don't know how many people were on there all saying hello at once. You couldn't understand anybody, but you're like, holy crap. When I hit mute, I was like, this is going to work. So we sold over 1,000 units of Ultimate Trading Machine a lot of that in the first launch, but certainly within the first 60 days or so. So for us, it was the first $1 million launch that we had. Obviously, my investment for $12,000 to Perry Marshall had a very nice ROI. Oh. I know. I asked for a refund. He said no. But it was clearly worth it. And that's really where I learned, and I started attending conferences, that you don't need to get a ton of great ideas. You just need to get one great idea out of that. If you just get a thought back in the hotel room after going to a conference that you can run with, that justifies the entire effort. Mm-hmm. So I, you know, it sort of changed my thinking on, you know, one, testing, because you just never know. And two, realizing you don't need a lot of great ideas when you start to learn how this machine works with lead generation and developing your lifetime value. So that's kind of where it started. That was the start of the course side of the business. And we really followed that path for quite a few years, but we started to realize, and this is more in the last few years, that people start to cycle back and they don't want to spend a lot of time learning. They think they do. They want to buy the course, because originally the big thing when you would deliver a course, it would come in a big box. It would have 10 DVDs. It would have to make a thud at their doorstep. That's what everybody wanted. You can't just deliver 60 minutes of video. It wasn't worth $1,000. It has to weigh a lot to be worth that money. So that's what we did. You know, we delivered big books and DVDs and printed everything. That obviously all changed. People really didn't want to consume that. They weren't consuming that. So we've gravitated now toward more of a hybrid approach, which is, yeah, there's training, but it's all obviously typically online. Nothing is delivered, of course, in the mail anymore. It's brief. It's to the point. And a lot of it now is done for you. So we'll show you how to do it. We realize 9 out of 10 of you won't do it. So for the 9 out of 10, we'll also provide the alert. So it's kind of interesting because we've almost gone full circle doing what we did in day one in 1996. We provide all that, but we provide a lot more of the background, sort of the insurance policy for people, like, okay, what if we stop tomorrow? You'll be okay because you also have our training. You've also you can also do it yourself. So it's kind of that combination of the two is where the business evolved to throughout these years.
Gotcha. And so it's a membership model in some ways, and then other people can just buy courses.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah. So they can buy the course, and then they can also buy the done for you element as well. Like Brian mentioned, his course itself, there's training. They don't have to continue in the live room, but you know, they sort of developed this sense of community. you know, they're with all these other traders doing the same thing. So people like to be part of that overall. It's not for everybody. Some people don't, so we make it optional.
So you mentioned competitors coming and going. What about you two? Was there any point where you're like, oh, I don't think this is going to continue on? Like, what were some of the low points for you?
That's a good question. I think when we've hit these little cycles that I mentioned, revenue seems to start to slow down. It seems to be more of a struggle to get customers. It seems to be a little bit more of a struggle to convert people, to get people to buy. We've had these conversations that me and Brian have had this conversation a few times where it's been like, huh, what are we going to do? I mean, you can sort of start to feel something has changed. Now, it might be something to do with the economy, the markets, a lot of things outside of our control. And then some of it is just things have evolved. You know, the places that people go to find information, even to this day, has changed a lot, right, in the last 18 months or 2 years. I mean, people aren't finding information the same ways. I mean, things like YouTube didn't exist, TikTok didn't exist, Twitter didn't exist. You know, new things come onto the scene. We've sort of had to always force ourselves to adopt. So, Brian, I know we've had conversations where we're like, crap, what are we going to do?
I mean, yeah, it's one of those that come to mind was 2008. I don't know if you recall, Mark, but we were pretty concerned about that whole financial crash and how we were going to do through that. You know, were we going to be able to ride out 12, 18 months of some slower sales? That ended up being one of the best times for us, which was just surprising and shocking, which I think is a point. A lot of times in business, you try different things and you never know how it's going to work out. And over the years, we've had to reinvent ourselves a number of times to stay relevant with the current marketing practices.
Yeah, that's awesome. Let's go to the deal closer. No, not deal closer. Let's go to the website closers.com, guys. Brent, when did you first become aware of Netpicks?
I think we just had an initial, I think you guys made an inquiry. I can't remember how you ultimately got to us. I remember our first conversation.
I think I bought another website through Website Closers and had bought and sold a few times with a couple others like Quiet Light and Empire Flippers. Had a good experience with you guys. I had seen that you had recently closed a deal or two in our space. Mm-hmm. And I think I told you that in the beginning. I always felt the buyer should and needs to be somebody in our niche. It's not mandatory, but I just felt it would be the best, you know, overall, best for us, best for my team, and best for the buyer. So I felt like there was a good chance you still had some people, you know, in your database that maybe missed out on those other opportunities. So that's why I put the inquiry in.
Yeah. I was curious what went into y'all's decision to ultimately pick, you know, going with a broker, not only, and then kind of after our first conversation, I never asked you guys that.
So Mark, what was going through your head at that time then? When did you start to think like, you know what, things are going well, but maybe it's time to sell the business.
Yeah, we had looked at this about 10 years ago, and we had actually hired a broker at that time, and we had a significant offer at that time, and it was, I forget the exact structure of the firm that was the main company that was looking to acquire us. It was called something different. It was basically some sort of venture capital type of firm, but they weren't in our niche, and one of the big requirements that they had was myself and Brian had to stay on in a management day-to-day role, and we had to retain a certain percentage of the company. And ultimately, I mean, we struggled with the decision because it was a good offer, but I didn't know these people and I didn't really know their experience, even in internet marketing at the time. And I was just concerned of that being kind of my new boss in a way, but also the people that we were going to have to work with. So we basically ended up just turning it down ultimately, because we either at that point wanted to unload it completely to somebody. We just weren't comfortable with somebody without kind of the knowledge base overall. So, you know, obviously years go by. On occasion, I would, you know, get emails. I would see somebody in my niche, you know, listed for sale. It's always a curiosity. Sometimes we would acquire some of those companies. We acquired probably 6 or 7 companies along the way, obviously much smaller than us, but it was a way for us to get additional content sites, additional customer bases. It worked very well for us. That was one of our main marketing strategies, I would say probably 5 to 10 years ago, we probably did a dozen different, you know, acquisitions, all smaller at the time, just to get customer databases, get products, things of that nature. So I was always kind of tapped into, you know, that side of it. But we ended up over the last few years having a really good run. You know, the business was growing. We're quite lean. We have a very small team, a great team, but we have a super high margin as a result. So it just sort of felt like, you know what, if we're going to attract somebody, this would be a good time. We could show them that we got through COVID amazingly well. We know that we've been through down market cycles before. We have that success. So that's not really a big concern. If we get a recession, yeah, sure, it's going to be a little bit of a reshifting a bit, but it's not going to really hurt the business. So the timing seemed somewhat ideal. And Brian is working on some other projects. So that kind of was something that's happened over the last, you know, year or so. And then I also just kind of felt like I needed a little bit more headspace to just do something else. So that was a lot of the thinking. I could talk about it forever because it was a huge decision. It wasn't easy because you do something for 2.5 decades. You know, it's not easy to just potentially offer it to somebody else. But that was kind of our thinking. And we decided, let's see if we can get somebody only at the right price. We're not desperate. We don't need to sell it. I still loved kind of what we were doing. I didn't dread waking up every morning. I still, even helping the new owners, I'm excited to help them. So I still enjoy it. So we just felt, but if we could find the right people, maybe this is the time to monetize what we've done.
Yep. Isaac, you doing all right?
We lost you for a minute.
I think we still lost him. All right. Well, Brent, Mark brings up an interesting point about, you know, whether or not a seller will go end up working for the buyer. I mean, you see both sides, obviously. How do both the buyers and sellers evaluate that on whether the buyer still needs to work for? Do I have that right? No. How do you buyers and sellers evaluate whether or not the seller is going to continue to work for the buyer?
I think they know pretty quick.
Hello.
And I've talked about this with Mark and Brian before. The very first call with their particular buyer.
I can't hear anything.
Well, we can hear you.
Oh, man. You probably want to start this over.
Yeah.
We'll cut this out a little bit. We'll put that editor to the test.
There we go.
Should we sign language him?
We sent a chat that we can hear him.
Can you guys hear me now?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. That was so weird.
Rain gotcha.
I don't know. My whole screen went black and then it like turned back on.
Whoa. All right. So Brent, You were saying about evaluating whether or not a seller is going to continue to work for a buyer.
Yeah, in my experience, they know pretty fast. And in this particular case, kind of the very first call, I sensed a pretty good synergy between the two. And I think it's because the industry is such a niche industry and they just both spoke the language really well. And this buyer and seller get to know each other pretty well over the few months it takes to close. And I think it's like, am I going to be married to this person for the next however many years? And, you know, they know pretty well. And I hope in this case that I think that you guys are getting along.
Yeah. I mean, I think you're right. The first call, there was just great synergy. Yes, it definitely helped that they were in our niche. We had other conversations with people in our niche as well. That was interesting, but it didn't have the same chemistry overall. It was appealing because they understood our industry and we knew that they could probably be successful. But the two guys in particular that ended up acquiring, you know, Netpicks, it was just, you could tell we were all the kind of people who probably would work together and would choose to be business partners with each other. We just kind of all sort of thought alike. We ran our businesses very much the same way. A lot of our philosophies were the same. So it helps to have that synergy because, you know, when you do this, there's a lot of trust. I mean, the buyer is putting a lot of trust in us. You know, one, when the deal closes, that we're going to be there for them, you know, whether we're working for them or not. I mean, that transitionary period is essential and it's scary for a buyer because they don't know for sure that you're going to be around. And then for us as a seller, you know, there may be aspects of the deal, some financing, some, you know, some earnouts, some loans. We have to have trust in them as well, not to screw things up. So it was pretty essential, pretty important to me that we felt that way. And I'm sure for them as well, because this was a big investment for them as well.
You know, it seems that this business is all about the recurring revenue, and you've got a track record of retaining your members. And Isaac, I mean, that had to be super attractive to a potential buyer.
Yeah. One of the things that I really loved about this business when we first met Mark and Brian, there were several things, but Mark mentioned the margin profile. So this business got an 82% gross margin, just very profitable, really well-managed business, long-term track record, 57% recurring revenue rate. So, you know, all these metrics that we know buyers love and really value, because it makes the cash flow of the business very predictable. And that's ultimately what buyers are looking for, is predictability of cash flows that they're paying a multiple on. So we were really excited about the listing. On the other hand, it's a super technical business. It takes a very specialized buyer with a high degree of knowledge. So we knew we were going to have to really have, you know, kind of the rifle approach to finding a buyer, as opposed to a shotgun approach. We wanted to hone in on buyers that, you know, were excited about the profitability of the business, but had the capability to actually execute and run this business, which is a small pool of potential buyers. Like Mark said, we had several transactions that we had recently executed on, so other companies kind of in the same category, although they didn't have the financial profile that Netpicks had. So we knew there were buyers out there for these kind of businesses. We knew that it could potentially be hard to find the perfect buyer, but we basically knew what we were going to be looking for. And so, you know, we were excited about the company and about the opportunity and about the potential that it could give to a buyer right after the first call we had. We kind of went to work on trying to put it all together right away.
So what happens then after you have the initial call and the buyer's like, yeah, this sounds amazing. I think we want to continue to evaluate it. And then ultimately you get to a letter of intent or whatever it comes out to, right? What were some of the hurdles getting through to ultimately the sale of the business?
I think from our perspective, I know the buyers needed to arrange financing, and that was going to be an extended process. They also were highly detailed in the due diligence, which we were fine with, but it was definitely an extensive due diligence process. I mean, we spoke on a regular basis every week, but it never bothered me because they always came super prepared with the questions. The questions were smart. They made sense. I sort of understood why they were asking them. And I don't know, I think it actually helped develop the relationship, you know, even further. And I think it got them more vested into getting the deal done, because I know that it was a lot of work on their side to actually get everything done, to get the financing, get the SBA loan. It was an incredible amount of effort that they had to go through. Our job was to continue to manage and maintain the business in the meantime, because it took, you know, multiple months to get to that process. You know, so we had to kind of keep focusing on what we were doing, always understanding that it was always possible the deal, you know, could fall through. So one of the challenges we had, and I know I probably whined about it some to Brian along the way, is we had some opportunities that we just didn't know what to do, because I wanted to move forward with some of them, but I knew realistically I'm making a decision that I shouldn't be making for a new owner. But at the same time, if that transaction doesn't go through, I've just missed out on an opportunity. So, you know, there were some times that were a little bit anxious, you know, a little anxiety. I mean, I had conversations with, you know, Brent and with Isaac multiple times. I mean, they were great every single time. I will say, we never once felt pressured that we had to do this deal. We had to get this deal done. It's the best we're going to get. I mean, they were always advocating, I believe, for us and to try to get us the most possible on the deal. And I never felt, when they heard me maybe hedging a little bit, either on this transaction or another one, I never once felt like they were like, oh, disappointed. They were just ready. We'll move on and we'll find the next, you know, the next perfect buyer. So that was what was really great about the process. We never felt pressure coming from the broker, which is not always how it works. I think in this industry, in some of my previous experiences, there's a lot of let's get the deal done. And this was more let's figure out how to get the deal done, but not insisting that we get this one, you know, completed. So that actually made it easier. So I think there was definitely some stress and some hurdles, but you know, that kind of helped, I think, us get through some of this.
Yeah. Was there skepticism from the buyer about the margins, about the revenue numbers? You mentioned they went through the diligence process. If I heard 82% margin, I'd be like, come on, is that right?
I mean, I'll probably let Brent and Isaac answer on this too, because they may have had different, obviously different conversations than I had. I think for us in these calls, I never worried about it because I knew our numbers were legit. Our numbers were easy to prove. So I think I was always just super confident. I was always like, throw anything at us. It doesn't matter. Everything in the write-up and the write-up that Website Closers did, I thought was amazing. I mean, I thought it completely encapsulated the business. It was the best one I've seen. You know, and like I said, we've been down the road before in this and other businesses. So that also gave me tremendous confidence. And so I guess I just never worried about it. I was just like, yeah, keep throwing stuff out, because if you're asking me those questions, you're super interested. I've got the evidence to back that up. So for me, it was never a concern. I never really worried about it, but I don't know, for Brent and Isaac, maybe it was different.
Well, one thing I'll say, and Brent and I were having a conversation about this just yesterday, the quality of financial reporting that that our clients have is so indicative of how successful we're going to be to get through the transaction, because buyers really are going to rely on that. And Mark and Brian had great financials. You know, when buyers, every buyer does diligence and kind of goes through the financial diligence process. And so when a buyer does that and then everything matches up like they're expecting, that gives them a lot of confidence. And that was the case here, where they asked for a lot of information, but there was never any discrepancy that anybody got concerned with. Conversely, you know, when we sell companies that haven't kind of gone into the transaction well prepared with good quality financial statements, it creates a lot of work during due diligence, and that can be scary for a buyer, right? Even if the questions are perfectly, you know, if the discrepancies that are found are legitimate and can be answered, just having them and kind of going through those processes can be fatiguing for both the buyer and the seller, and it can cause a lack of confidence. And so, you know, I think you guys did a great job of having clean financials. I think we had a number of ad backs that we had represented, but we had all the supporting documentation for that. We had good records. And so I think the buyers did their homework on it, but everything, you know, was, just like Mark said, it was just, you know, ask the questions and we'll give you the answers. And they did a great job of kind of producing that documentation and the answers as we went through.
Yeah, and to Mark and Brian's credit, it was always a very quick turnaround on any information asked, and so it made the process really, really great.
So what can you share about the ultimate transaction in terms of numbers, in terms of how long you have to, not have to, how long you're staying with the company? What can you share?
Yeah, so, you know, we did end up at the high end of the asking range. I guess I'll let Brett and Isaac speak to that a little bit. But we did get what we were looking for as far as the multiple goes. That was important to us, like I mentioned, because we were fully ready to walk away from the process and continue doing what we were doing. So we felt like if we could get at this multiple, then, and the right buyer, we can go ahead and make the sale happen. So we definitely achieved that. Website Closers definitely brought us the right buyer at the right multiple. We did have to negotiate on terms. So there is some consulting arrangements that were made for after the sale. There is a note as well. And this will kind of stretch on for up to 5 years. So, but the bulk of it was upfront, was cash, and that was important to us as well. We were okay with providing some financing. I think that's understandable and what people want, especially to feel confident about this size of a deal. But we also wanted to make sure that the bulk, let's say 80% or more, was going to be cash up front, and then we were happy to finance some aspects of it. Another thing that was important from the buyer's perspective is they wanted myself, Brian, and one other partner to stay on with the business at least for some time and maybe a long time. So we did negotiate that separately, have, you know, some separate arrangements basically, and I think each one of us more than happy to do that. in some different roles. And my situation, just in a bit more of a reduced capacity role, that was part of the reason to sell. So I have time to do some other things. And so I was able to negotiate that, and they can keep me on as long as they want if I'm providing value. And if not, it's okay too. So that was sort of what we negotiated. So that also makes the transition, you know, kind of nice, because it is a little scary when you sort of sell a cash machine like this. I mean, that's the one thing I've noticed since I've sold. I think I've mentioned this to Brian, is like sometimes like you're, I don't know, I'm flying recently, and you know, to go buy the internet on the plane for the $40 or $50, you don't even think twice about it when you have this cash machine. When you've sold your business, you don't have the cash machine anymore. Like, huh, okay, it's $40, $50. Do I really need the internet? So you start to have these, you know, little decisions about things that I never thought twice about any of this stuff before. So it is nice to sort of have a bit of this recurring, a bit of these payouts over time. You know, it gives you a bit of a soft landing as you start to figure out what, you know, the next opportunity is going to be. But I don't know, anybody else want to sort of speak to the deal or the transaction?
Yeah, I'll just say we were thrilled with it. We were in a, I think, a desirable position of having multiple offers. We were able to get to a full price offer and close there. The terms never changed from kind of the time that we got the LOI signed. We closed with that same enterprise valuation. So you know, all good things. I think there was an SBA loan involved here, so that does create a little more rigorous process and takes a little extra time. So we work through that. But it also, the SBA loan also does help to increase the percentage of cash at closing, because of the leverage that the buyer is able to get. So it was, you know, I think worth the wait. And, you know, Mark and Brian were just great to work with, great with the buyers, really good, you know. I thought we had a lot of great discussions, candid conversations sometimes. I think Brent and I were very involved with negotiating a structure that, you know, that the buyers could afford basically, and that worked for Mark and Brian. And so I felt good that we were able to get to that place where, you know, everybody was, I think, happy with the transaction.
Awesome. Isaac, last question for you. Courses, membership sites, these types of companies have exploded recently. You know, what kind of multiples are we looking at, you know, for those types of companies?
So one of the things we look at, we look at the recurring revenue rate, we look at the churn. So we'll look at kind of how long, if it's a monthly subscription model, how long those customers stay with the subscription. And then we look at the acquisition costs. So how expensive it is to acquire the customer. And we compare that to the lifetime value of that customer relationship. And so that can be really broadly different. You know, a company that has a subscription model, like we've seen some subscription box businesses, right? Where they, you know, it's a $40 purchase price and their average customers stay 3 months. That's a much different model than something like Netpicks, where you've got a much higher average purchase price and a much longer lived relationship with the client. One of the other things that was interesting about Netpicks is the number of clients. If we looked at the number of clients that Netpicks had kind of over the full, you know, 25 plus year history. And I think there were, there was an email database of over 500,000 subscribers. So, you know, we looked at that as an opportunity to kind of monetize those prior clients and bring some of those back in. But to answer your question about multiples can kind of range from, you know, the other thing that's important is the direction of the revenues, right? So if the business is growing and increasing, that is a much more valuable business than one in decline. And we've certainly seen on the e-commerce side a lot of businesses in decline right now. But you know, the range could be anywhere from 3 to 10, with 10 being, or even higher sometimes on the SaaS side. So where we really see the multiples start to get, you know, in that above 6 range is on software subscription models, because the cost of maintaining those customers over the long term is very low. And so the cash flows get very profitable over time.
3 to 10 net or gross?
3 to 10 times the free cash flow, which we call SDE, seller discretionary earnings. So it's the cash flow available to the buyer. And I would say a lot of transactions we're seeing right now are in the 4 to 5 X range. You know, the 10X deals really are SaaS, and that's a different type of business model.
Cool. Well, I know a company that can help sell any of those companies.
We love them. Yeah, we love them, and we enjoy working through the process.
All right, Brian and Mark, I'll get you out of here on these last two questions. So when you sold the business, you got a little bit of cash. Brian, how did you celebrate? What was a purchase that you made?
That's funny. Nothing.
Nothing. That's exciting.
My wife asked me the same thing. Are you going to go out and get a new car? The answer is no. I mean, at the end of the day, it's cash. And as a serial entrepreneur, and Mark and I are having these conversations. In fact, we have a call right after this. What do we do to deploy the cash to continue making money? That's how I look at it. So it's not like we got all this cash and we're going to go out and party. So that's the reason for my answer, straight up. For me, it's all about what can I do to make some more money? And who knows, maybe we'll get with Website Closers and see if they've got a smaller web business that we can partake in.
Always a serial entrepreneur. Mark, what about you? Did you buy anything, or you're just like, no, let me find the next business?
Took the private jet to Vegas. That was the first thing I did. Lost it all. And and now I got to work for Brian. So
Mark said one of the funniest things via text. I don't think we were waiting. The day we closed, we were waiting on the wire transfer or something. I said, have you got the wire yet? And he tops back, no, standing by at the blackjack table.
I kept canceling the jet. It was on. It was off. It was off.
Canceling the jet and have to re-ice the champagne.
Yep. It's tough, man. So, no, for me, Brian's exactly right. I don't know. I already have a good life. So I'm just kind of continuing doing that. I've done some travels, but I was doing travels before throughout this whole deal. I was traveling. So just kind of continued with that. The fun part now has been figuring out how to deploy the capital. You know, we want to have some passive income as well. So figuring out where we can deploy the capital, where it's passive, and then obviously save some of the capital for something that is, you know, that's not passive, that's going to have some good cash flow. So that's exactly right. It may be something from Website Closers. It will absolutely be something online. No real exciting big purchases, but, you know, I think kind of like Brian, I've got really what I need at this point. It's just a matter of, finding some of those opportunities. So, you know, a little bit in real estate, there's been some things that we've already made some moves on.
Awesome. Always looking for the next thing.
Yep.
Well, guys, thank you so much for sharing your story. Brian, how can listeners connect with you?
You can email me at brian@netpicks.com.
Cool. Mark?
I'm mark@netpicks.com. So I'm still there.
All right. Awesome. Well, guys, I appreciate the time today. What a great story. And I can't wait to see what you build next.
Thanks, Jason.
Yeah, thanks so much.
All right. That was Mark Soberman and Brian Short. I can't wait to see what they come up with next. Thanks, everyone, for listening to this episode of the Deal Closers Podcast, brought to you by WebsiteClosers.com. If you like the show, be sure to rate us, write a review, press the follow button, or share with your network. And of course, if you're looking for help selling your e-commerce business, be sure to visit websiteclosers.com. This episode was edited and produced by Earfluence. I'm Jason Gilliken, and we'll see you next time on the Deal Closers Podcast. Mm-hmm.